Hi everyone, welcome back to SFDC Panther. And from this video, we are going to learn batch effects. So here is the agenda for the today that we are going to learn, and what are the key takeaways from this session. We will see what is the batch effects, when we actually need to go for the batch effects, and then we will also see some examples where we can go with the batch effects instead of regular sample FS class. And then we will see what are the different types of batch effects, and then we'll also see all the methods of batch effects and its explanation, what are the methods and what they do. And then we will also see what is the exact life cycle of batch effects. So whenever we are executing a batch effects, either from a anonymous window or from a particular class, what are the stages that a batch effects class go through with. And then we will see what are the different interfaces in batch effects and what is the use of all those interfaces. And then we will have some Q&A round. So let's go ahead and start from the introduction. So batch effects is nothing, it's a piece of code that gets executed in the future whenever Salesforce resources are free. So we can say inside the batch effects, the code runs in a future and we can process the data in a bulk. So how many number of records we can process is our we can process up to 50 million records in a single batch, that is equivalent to 5 crores. So when to use, so the reason behind, as we discussed, that a batch class can process up to 50 million records, that means whenever there is a need to perform some kind of logic in a bulk data, then we should go for batch effects. And what is the reason, what are some examples? Let's say there is a company called Airtel, that is a mobile service provider, and what the concept they are following currently, they are disabling the outgoing services for all those numbers who had not made a recharge after every 30 days. So let's say that if you are using a mobile number that is of Airtel service provider and you have not made any recharge after 30 days, after the last recharge you have made, and then after 30 days you are not making any recharge, then your outgoing services for your mobile will be disabled. You will not be able to make any calls with that particular number. Even if you have the balance, that doesn't matter. So in that case, what process they can follow, what process they are following is, they are writing a batch apex behind the scene, which is fetching all those mobile records who had not made any recharge in last 30 days and then disabling their outgoing services. This is a simple scenario, and you can say that it's a big service provider which has millions or billions of users who are using their services. So in that case, there will definitely be bulk of records that they need to disable their outgoing services. And in the other counterpart, they also need to enable the services if the user has made recharge after 4 or 5 days in activity of outgoing services. Then they also need to fetch all those records who has made recharge recently. We can say who had made recharge today or within 1 hour. They need to activate their outgoing services. So this is how, this is a first example where we can go. And the second example is that there is an e-commerce site. We can take an example of Amazon, where every minute many users are placing the order, and then the order is being placed, they are getting notified, and then after they are also getting notified about their order status, what is the current order status for their particular order. So in that case, you can write a particular batch apex, fetch all those records whose order status is not completed and send the email to the customers, and the email will send in a bulk way, and there might be the customers who are placing an order in a single day, there might be 10,000, there might be millions of records. So we can take that example from there as well. And the other thing is that you have your customers and you also need to send the invoices on a particular regular interval basis. Let's say that you wanted to send the invoices for all those customers who have placed the order in 1 day. So in that case, there might be possibility that you have millions, billions of customers thousands of customers who are placing the order and you need to send the invoice. In that case, you cannot follow a simple terminology by going to the each and every record and clicking on send invoice button. That will be a very hectic and time consuming process. In that case, you can also go and write a batch apex, send the invoices to your customers who has placed the order in that day. So these are 2-3 examples where you can use batch apex, and in a real time scenario you will also get more and more examples for batch apex. And then what are the type of batch apex? So there are two types of batch apex. One is query locator, that we will be mainly focus on this video, and then the other one is iterator. This is a custom iterator that we will discuss about this in a complete separate video for that. And then we have different interfaces that we can use, that we generally use while we are working with Salesforce batch apex classes. So what are, one is database.allowsCallout, other one is database.stateful, to store the states of all our variables that we have created under that particular apex batch. AllowsCallout gives us the ability to make the external callout or to internal Salesforce APIs as well. System.schedulable interface to schedule a particular batch apex or a single class. And then system.iterator, that is used for creating a custom iterator batch. And then we have database.batchable interface. So the last interface is the one who is actually responsible for creating a batch apex, creating a batch class. So this is a very simple skeleton of a batch apex that I put here. This does nothing. It's a very simple, we can say, a blueprint of a batch apex. So here you can say that we have created a global class, and the reason why we are taking the class as a global, because the interface that we are implementing here, database.batchable, this is defined as a global while they have developed that interface. So this is the reason we have to make our access modifier as a global. And then we have three methods defined under this particular batchable interface, so we have to give the implementation for all those methods. So for start, as we discussed, we have two kind of return type. Either it will be query locator or it will be iterator. And then it takes two parameters, database.batchable context, and it returns a query. Actually, it execute the query and then returns the records to the execute method on the second parameter, that is scope. And then we have finish. Finish is the exit where we can put our exit logic, the last method of our batch apex. And even if you want to add your own methods, feel free to add. You can add, there is no limitations that inside a batch class there will be only three methods. There is no limitation for that. Even you can create your own constructor as well. So these are the some explanation, some very basic explanation about start method. So the start method, we can say this is the starting point of our batch apex. From that method, apex batch class starts, and it takes a query, executes that query, and then returns the method, returns the record to the execute method, as we already discussed earlier. And then finish method, we can say that this is the actual heart of our batch apex, where we either put all the logic inside this execute method, or we call some handler class or some helper class for this batch apex to process the logic that we wanted to process for multiple records. And then this takes two parameter, one is batchable context and the other parameter that gets the record from start method. And then we have finish method. This is the method, and we can also say the last method of batch apex, where we usually write exit method. We can say that this is the exit method. We write the exit logic here, like modifying or notifying to the user that the batch has been successfully completed, with or without errors. Or you can call some another batch apex from the finish method, and you can also send some information about how many numbers of records were processed and how many number of records were success and fail, you can send the count as well in the with the help of finish method in an email you wanted to send to the user. So what is the batch apex life cycle? So basically, whenever we are executing a batch apex, either from anonymous window or calling from some another batch or some simple class, so it always starts from holding stage. That means you have executed your apex batch and the batch has been sent to the apex flex queue, and then the batch is waiting for its turn to get executed. And then if the flex queue has the maximum number of batch apex, that is total in 100, then it will immediately go to the failed state. Otherwise, it will wait for the queued state. And then queued state means that it is waiting for their execution. In the preparing, the start method is executing for batch apex, and then once it will get executed, it will go to processing. That means now our execute method is actually being executed, and it depends upon the number of records and the number of chunks how many times the execute method will get executed. And if the user is coming and then aborting the batch, then it will go to the aborted stage. Otherwise, from processing state, it will go to completed, and in completed state, there might be some batch which were failed and there might be some which were success. And then if this is the failed stage, that comes in two cases: either there are maximum number of flex queue or the maximum number of record written by the SQL query are more than 50 million records. So this is a explanation of each and every stage that we discussed. So if you say that about the holding stage, the same thing, that it is flex queue and until resource becomes available to the queue to the job processing. And here we have job is awaiting the execution, and in case of preparing, we have the start method of the job, processing, aborted, completed, and failed. So we already discussed all the stages. So what next we have? We have different interfaces. What are the different interfaces that we can use while we are working with batch apex? So first interface is database.batchable that we discussed. This is the interface that is responsible for creating a batch apex. And while when we have implemented this interface, we need to make sure that we have made the access modifier of our class as a global, and we have implemented all three methods, that are start, execute, and finish. And then we have database.stateful. What this interface does and how it is helpful to us. So we discussed that if you wanted to send the information about how many numbers of records were there, how many numbers of records were success and were failed. So to hold the value, or to hold the state of our variables, we basically use database.stateful. So in that case, what we can do is we can create three parameters, three variables. We can say one will be holding the total records, one will be holding for success, one will be holding for failed. And then inside execute method, we will be doing the process. Like for total records, we will be just getting the size of our scope, whatever we have got on the second parameter of execute method. And for the failed record, we can take the help of database class, where we can use database.update, delete, or insert, upsert. We can use that, and which will return database.save result, delete result, upsert result in case of whatever we operation we are performing. And then in that there we can put our logic to get the success and error records. And then database.allows callouts. This is the interface that enables the functionality, or we can say that gives us the power to make the external callouts. That means if you wanted to consume the web services of third-party system, or we wanted to consume the web services of Salesforce itself, like we wanted to use the tooling API, or we wanted to use some metadata API from the batch apex. And then we have system.iterator that we discussed, that this interface is basically used for creating the custom iterator badge that we will discuss in a separate video. And now we have Q&A session. So we already discussed a lot about batch apex, what batch apex does, or how to use, when to use, what are the examples, interfaces, types. So these are some questions that I have listed. So we will be going one by one. So first question is, can we call batch apex from another batch apex? So the answer is yes, we can call, but the catch is we can only call from finish method. You cannot call batch apex from execute method. The reason is execute method may execute multiple times based on the batch size, and start method we cannot call. And then second question is, can we call future from apex batch and vice versa? That means if you have a future method in separate class, can we call future method from batch apex? The answer is straightforward, no, we cannot call. We cannot call either from batch to future, or we cannot call batch from future. There is no way we cannot call a future from batch or batch from future. So the third question is that what logic we should put inside finish method. So inside finish method we always put exit logic. We say exit logic. Why we say that exit logic? Because the finish method is the exit method, the last method of that for that batch apex class, where we can write the logic for sending an email to notifying the user about the batch status, if you wanted to send the information about the number of records and all, or if you wanted to call some another batch apex inside that from that particular batch. Let's say that you wanted to ensure the order of your batch. You are saying that first this particular batch should be executed, and then from the when this particular batch has been executed, you have to manipulate some values based on the output of first batch. Then you can call second batch inside that from the first batch. And then we have, what is the maximum number of job can be placed inside a flex queue? So we already told that there are can be maximum number of job which are in flex queue. That means in holding stage is 100. So what if the user is trying to execute another batch apex when the batch flex queue is in its full capacity? Then we need the batch apex will immediately fail and will get into the failed stage that we discussed. And then we have, what are the maximum number of jobs in an execution stage? So there can be only one job which will be in execution stage. That means in a processing stage, the execute method of any batch apex. And then can we make caller from batch apex? Yes, we can make, but for that we have to implement an interface that is called as database.allowsCallouts. And then we have, what are the maximum number of callouts that we can make from a batch apex? So this is a trick question where you will see in this question you are asking what are the maximum number of callouts that we can make from a batch apex. So for every method of a single batch, in a batch apex we have three methods. One is start, one is execute, and the last one is finish. So from each and every method we can make 100 callouts. So let's say that if you have a start method, you can make 100 callouts. You have finish method, you can make 100 callouts. And then in execute method, you can make 100 callouts in each execution. So let's say that if your batch apex is executing 5 times, then you can make 500 callouts in that particular execute method, because your execute method is executing 5 times. And then what are the maximum number of records that can be processed from a single batch apex? That is 50 million, equivalent to 5 crores. And then what is the default minimum and maximum batch size? So this is the criteria by which the execute method actually, the batch size, the execute size actually get defined. So the default batch size of a batch apex is 200. Minimum that we can provide is 1, and the maximum that can provide is 2000 in case of query locator. And in case of system iterator, we don't have any kind of limitation on the upper limit. The lower limit will remain same as a 1 and default will remain as the same 200. But when we talk about upper limit, that is maximum batch size, there is no limitations in case of iterator batch. And then what are the maximum number of async method that can be executed or that can be processed in a single day? So when we say that async method, it includes future, it includes queueable, and it includes batch effects. So these are 250,000. If you have exceeded this maximum number of limits, you will not be able to process, you will not be able to execute any async method in that particular day. You can execute after the limit of 24 hours has been resetted by the Salesforce itself. So this is it for the session. We have discussed some basic about the batch effects. The key takeaways that we discussed were what is the batch effects, when to use, what were the examples when we used, we can go for batch effects, and we should use for batch effects. And then what were the type of batch effects, what were the different interfaces that we will be using while we are working with the batch effects, and what are their significance, what are their used in batch effects. And then we also saw what is the sample blueprint of a batch effects. And then we also learned about the each and every method of batch effects, what does mean by each and every method, and what did do in Salesforce. And then in the last we had some Q&A discussion. So this is it. In the next video, I will be starting from a batch effects. Thank you guys.